All right, I think we'll get started. Thank you once again for taking the time to join the second part of our webinar series on MODFLOW-USG. My name is Wayne Hesch. I'm the product manager for Visual MODFLOW here at the Schlumberger Water Services in Canada. If you're new to WebEx, there's a chat option available on the toolbar. Just mouse over there and you can send a message to me directly. If possible, please leave the comment until the end so that we can try and get through within the time that we have allocated. And we'll be doing a recording of this webinar along with the previous one from this morning, and then we'll be posting the one of those versions on our website within the next few days. So as mentioned, this is the second part of our webinar series on MODFLOW-USG. There was a lot of content to cover, so we thought it'd be ideal to break that into a two-part series with the theory and applications covered by Sarab last week, and then today focusing on the GUI. And I think that went quite well, and I appreciate, again, you, those that are on the line attending, yes, last week's session and also this week's session. If you missed the session last week, we've recorded that. It's now on our website. You go to swstechnology.com/MODFLOW-USG. There's a landing page that we've created with links to various blog articles, white papers, et cetera, that we've been developing for MODFLOW-USG over the past, I guess, 3 to 4 months. And we also have a multimedia section on there with links to the webinar from last week, along with some of the YouTube demo videos that we've posted recently. So the webinar today hopefully should take about 40, 45 minutes. If there's time, I'll do a live demonstration at the end. And then, as mentioned, I'll leave questions at the end. Start by talking about the packaging. So MODFLOW-USG capabilities will be available in the Pro and Premium versions, which will be version 2014.1, slated for release, sometime in the middle to late November. As Sarab introduced last week, Visual MODFLOW Flex supports Voronoi grid cells, and the talk today will focus on what those are, what the benefits are of those grid cells, and how they can be used effectively for MODFLOW-USG. During the test that we've done so far, it's recommended that you use the 64-bit version. Seems like most of our users have migrated onto 64-bit platforms anyhow, so this shouldn't be a problem, mostly because the 3D visualization of these unstructured grids is a lot more memory intensive than a standard MODFLOW grid. This is something that will improve through future developments, but for now, if you do use the 32-bit version, you may reach some limits in terms of the grid size you can develop. So if possible, try and use the 64-bit version wherever possible. So just to recap some of the key benefits of MODFLOW-USG, and this is something I'll focus on throughout the talk today. The first is the ability to refine the grid around your wells and boundary conditions, similar to what you can do with finite elements. Smaller cells around the areas of interest results in higher accuracy. Fewer cells overall results in better runtime. So you don't need to have global grid refinement or a whole bunch of extra cells outside the area of interest. So you're essentially getting the best of both worlds. You're having more accuracy and fewer total number of cells in the groundwater in the grid, and this results in better runtimes. With MODFLOW-USG, the layers do not need to extend across the entire model domain, and this is a limitation with both structured versions of MODFLOW and with the fee flow. So in those cases, if you have discontinuities, you'd have to maintain a minimum layer thickness where you have, you know, whatever 1 centimeter cell thickness in certain regions. That can be problematic and introduces its own stability and essentially just adds more extra cells than are needless. So with MODFLOW-USG, you don't have to maintain that minimum layer thickness anymore. This means there's fewer cells. It will provide a better and more accurate representation of complex stratigraphy where you have steep gradients or vertical flows. And overall, this should improve the model stability and convergence, resulting in better runtimes. Lastly, MODFLOW-USG is built on the capabilities that were added to MODFLOW NWT. So it has the Newton-Raphson formulation, and as Sarab touched on that last webinar, this results in improved numerical stability. And by using the upstream weighting formulation with the layer type 4, you have this eliminates essentially the dry cell problem that's been longstanding in traditional versions of MODFLOW. In the webinar last week, Sarab, towards the end, had a slide discussing some tips for MODFLOW-USG, for using MODFLOW-USG, and I brought this forward into my presentation today because I thought a few of the points were well-suited to the philosophy that we have with Visual MODFLOW Flex. So the two items that are highlighted, which you may not be able to see, the first item is essentially start with a simple grid and add complexity as needed. So strive for persimmony, essentially. This is ideally supported in Visual MODFLOW Flex because you can start with a simple grid with just basic refinement, run the model, see if you get convergence, reasonable results, and if so, then you can introduce more complexity as you need to later on. So you can generate several numerical grids with different refinement levels to see which one provides the most suitable balance between run times, accuracy, and convergence. Second thing he suggested was to develop parallel models so that you have a equivalent MODFLOW 2005 model with your MODFLOW-USG model, just to keep with familiarity and check that the things that you're doing are working comparably to a traditional MODFLOW 2005 model. And again, we have this capability within Visual MODFLOW Flex. Once you have your conceptual model developed, you can convert that to a structured MODFLOW 2005 model or to an unstructured grid in parallel. So you can run several numerical models side by side, see which one gives the best results, and check essentially the accuracy or performance of MODFLOW-USG against your structured MODFLOW 2005 model. So the workflow that we have in Visual MODFLOW Flex for MODFLOW-USG is illustrated on this slide. It starts with defining your conceptual model. And there's, if you're not familiar with the approach that we have, you can refer to some of the previous webinars we've done. These are available on YouTube, where it discusses how to bring in your raw GIS data, what's involved with defining the geological structure, the property zones with raster grids, shapefile, et cetera, and then also your boundary conditions with polylines for rivers, points for wells, et cetera, or polygons for recharge zones, for example. You then proceed on to defining an unstructured grid. So your conceptual representations of your boundary conditions are included as add-ins for the grid, so the points, polylines, and polygons. You then define the refinement options and define the approximate number of total number of cells that you want in the grid. You then overlay the unstructured grid with the conceptual model and convert that to a numerical model, which results in the cell representation of the numerical model. So you have the ability to view and edit properties, view and edit the boundary conditions, and also add calibration data for charting, and then create the input files for MODFLOW-USG. After running a simulation, you can interpret the results both qualitatively and quantitatively, so you can look at contours of head, drawdown, fluxes, and also look at your calculated versus observed data for your head observations. If the model doesn't provide enough accuracy or takes too long to run, for example, you can easily go back and create another grid representation and run that process again. Or likewise, you can create a structured MODFLOW 2005 grid and run through the same steps. Let's move on then to the grid generation, since this is really the big difference with MODFLOW-USG over traditional versions of MODFLOW. I'll start by talking about what are Voronoi grid cells. There's been a few discussions about those previously and in the webinar and also on our website. Basically, if you're familiar with Delaunay triangulation, you should be, for the most part, familiar with what Voronoi tessellations are. So a Voronoi tessellation is a way of dividing space into a number of regions. You have a set of points, which are often called seeds or generators, are specified up front, and for each seed, there'll be a corresponding region that consists of all the points close to that seed than to any other. These regions are called Voronoi cells or Voronoi polygons. The entire object is sometimes called a Voronoi tessellation. And as shown on the screen there, it's really a dual object to a Delaunay triangulation. And for those that have worked with the finite element or specifically T-flow modeling, you should be familiar with Delaunay triangulation concepts. These Voronoi tessellations are used in a number of applications, including other technology, other simulators, science, art even, and even the video game industry. So we chose these Voronoi grid cells for unstructured grids for a number of reasons. They handle complicated geometries and boundaries quite well, very similar to what you can do with triangles or finite elements. They closely honor the CVFD geometry constraints. And again, the CVFD is a control volume finite difference formulation that's used by MODFLOW-USG. And those constraints are illustrated in the image in the top right. Essentially, what you need to have is the connecting line between adjacent cell centers needs to cross the shared edge at a 90-degree angle and should bisect that shared edge. As you start to deviate away from that condition, then you can get more errors, and that's where the ghost node correction package is utilized. When we generate these Voronoi grids, the well and the boundary nodes coincide exactly with the grid nodes, so again, you don't have any offset or correction that you need to apply. So in conclusion, by using these grid cells, we don't need to correct the heads or fluxes with the ghost node correction package, and this should result in higher accuracy and better convergence. So the grid generation approaches are quite different for MODFLOW-USG over traditional structured MODFLOW. Those that have worked with FEEFLOW before will be a little more familiar with, actually should be quite familiar with how the approach is with MODFLOW-USG. So with the structured MODFLOW 2005, for example, you start by defining your model extents, you overlay a uniform grid, and then you would refine the grid around the areas of interest. Those could be well fields, areas of contamination where you need improved resolution, et cetera. As we all know, when you do that refinement, it results in a whole bunch of extra cells outside the area of interest, and this can result in convergence or stability issues. With MODFLOW-USG, you have your points, polylines, and polygons are add-ins to the grid generator. And then you can refine the grid around individual wells and boundaries. So you can have different refinement level factors around wells, different refinement factors around the model edge, or along polyline segments. And that's something we'll discuss in the next couple slides. So another illustration, you have your conceptual objects with shape files representing your river boundary conditions in the upper left in the conceptual model. After generating the unstructured grid, you can see a nice level of refinements around those river polylines. After realizing the grid or running the conversion, you can see the corresponding cell representation of the river cells in the numerical model. Likewise, a similar capability is possible if you're just working with the simple example where you have a dewatering project, whether it's an excavation or a mine dewatering. You have some wells that are located in the middle of your model extents. These are represented as points in your conceptual model. During the grid generation, you specify what target cell size you want around those wells, and the grid generator will create the corresponding cell representation which honors those constraints. So again, you can see you have a nice level of refinement around those wells, gradual smoothing as you work your way outwards. This example is also nice because it shows that you can refine along the edges of the model extent with a specified refinement factor as well. In Visual MODFLOW Flex, we use the triangle grid generator. Those that have worked with FEEFLOW should be familiar with triangles as one of the more commonly used mesh generators. It's a robust and quick 2D mesh generator and Delaunay triangulator. It provides reasonable default settings for unstructured grids, specifically the Voronoi tessellations. Has a number of options for doing smooth grid refinement, and also has the various intelligent means to add control points that improve the CVFD criteria. There was a question that came in. I'll answer it quickly. Can you use the VMODFLEX USG version with PEST and MT3DMS? No, the USG doesn't support transport yet. I believe Sarab has his own transport code in there. And as he mentioned in the webinar last week, it sounds like they might be updating MT3DMS to work with MODFLOW-USG as well. And the Visual MODFLOW Flex does not support PEST for this first version. That's something we'll add for a future release. So the first step in the grid generator is to provide those add-ins. As mentioned, by default, all your conceptual boundary additions will be included, so you can turn off certain things. For example, you may not want to refine around tiled recharge polygons, for example. On the flip side, you can add in additional constraints. So if you want to refine the grid around your head observation points, that can be done. And the vertices from these polylines and polygons will be automatically included as the cell generators for the grid generator. In the second step, you specify a number of settings. First is the total number of cells, which is an approximation. The grid generator is not going to exactly honor what you put in for that value. So it's more of, for example, you want the total number of cells on the order of a magnitude. So for example, you may want 10,000, 50,000, or 100,000. So again, it's just an approximation. Usually it's plus or minus 20 or 30%. You then specify the refinement around each of the geometrical objects, and you'll note that each option, let me just highlight that. Each one of these here has different refinement factors. So you can specify to refine around the model edge and enter a target cell size. You can also refine around your line add-ins and specify a target cell size which is different. And then lastly, you can specify your target cell size around well. So perhaps you want 200 meters cell size approximately around your linear boundary additions, but then you want 50 meters cell size around your points. So this is all possible with this grid generator. The last option is the gradation shown at the bottom here. And what this does is it controls the change in the cell size around the refinement region so that you can either have a steep change in cell size, which results in a sharp change from the refinement region to the adjacent cells. This is probably not recommended because then you'll likely start to deviate away from the CBFD criteria. What's generally recommended is to have a gradual change in the cell size from adjacent cells so that those perpendicular bisector condition is met as close as possible. The smooth option then will result in a gradual change from in cell size. And I believe the next slide, will highlight that. So this example, we have two points in the middle of the model domain. And with the steep gradation option, you'll see you have very small cells going to rather large cells quite quickly. When you enable the smooth option, you'll see that the cell size from the refinement region to the outer perimeter, sort of the outer lying regions, will change more gradually or smoothly. After the grid's generated, you can preview what the grid looks like before you generate it. So if you see that you're getting too detailed of a refinement around certain regions, you can quite easily go back and adjust some of the parameters and then regenerate it. After the grid's generated, you can preview that in the 3D viewer, and then as mentioned with VModFlex, you can go back and generate multiple numerical discretizations with different grid levels of refinement and try several numerical models within one project. This is the resulting grid refinement around the pumping wells. In this case, we used or entered 50 meter cell spacing around the wells, and you can see what the corresponding cell geometry looks like. Just to refresh your memory on the concepts with USG, so with MODFLOW-USG, it doesn't really care what cell geometry is used. So you can see in this example, the cell around the pumping well has 10 sides, whereas adjacent cells looks like five-sided polygons. Really, the only thing that it's concerned about in the grid discretization is that you enter the cell connections, which cells are connected to a specific cell, the connection lengths, and the areas between the adjacent cells. While we were doing benchmarking several months ago, we came across some interesting results, and I guess it's quite something that most of us are aware of, but you can see it quite dramatically change and see how the impact of the grid refinement can impact the observed head at specific pumping wells. So we were benchmarking the Voronoi grid cells and comparing to equivalent feed flow models. And what you have on the y-axis here is the observed head at a specific pumping well, and on the x-axis is the different refinement factors. This is just a simple 2D example. So with 25 meter cell size, We observed the observed head was around 25 meters. As you work your way down to 5, 2, and 1 meter cell size around the well, the drawdown, the observed head drops significantly. You can see that you get close to about 10 meters observed head for a 1 meter level refinement. So this is something that can be done quite easily through the grid generator. As you change the level of refinement, it doesn't really increase the total number of cells quite dramatically. It just in that region it will. So this is something that the triangle grid generator does quite well, and you can easily experiment with several refinement levels to see which one gives the most suitable level of accuracy for your problem. Obviously, as you get closer down to 1 meter, that it more closely approaches the analytical solution. We also did some benchmark work comparing these to the CLN package. So once the grid is generated, you can then convert this to your numerical model. The process can be repeated a number of times, as I mentioned previously, so you can have a collection of numerical models for your specific project, which makes it ideal for comparing various numerical models as a means of uncertainty analysis. After the conversion, you'll have a new workflow navigator that appears. The workflow is a window that's shown on the screen here. You have a set of steps that you proceed through from essentially looking at the properties and boundary conditions, translating or creating the input files, running the simulation, and interpreting the results. If you're unfamiliar with this approach, this is how we navigate both conceptual and numerical models in Visual MODFLOW Flex. You can use the forward and back buttons as shown above the workflow panel here for proceeding to different steps. Or once you've gone through the workflow, you can just click on a different a specific step and it'll take you back to that point. Once a numerical model is created, it'll also be added to the model tree in the bottom left corner of the window. You'll have the numerical representation of the properties with the different parameter groups, so your hydraulic conductivity, your initial heads, and your storativity. You have your each of the boundary conditions that have been defined in the project with their cell representation. From here, you can turn objects on or off and add them to 3D viewers. And the items in the model tree are used to access the various options for editing the parameters and also the display settings. So first, you look at the properties. You can render those by zone or attribute in a 3D viewer. You can show discrete coloring or a gradual smoothing. These can be displayed as cells or color map with contour lines. There's various options in the 3D viewer where you can show properties for specific layers or along cross sections, and you can also show cutaways. The example in the bottom middle there would be initial heads defined where in the conceptual model the initial heads were defined with a raster grid such as a surfer grid or an Esri grid, and what you see is a corresponding numerical representation for that. In the bottom right, you have a number of property zones for a specific layer that are shown. So there's a few illustrations that show what those different display options are. In the top left, you have a slice along a cross-section where you specify a location, and it'll collect the corresponding unstructured grid cells that follow that specific plane. You can do a flat or projected version of that as a color map in the top right here. For the color maps, you can also show contour lines for parameter values such as hydraulic conductivity or calculated heads. And in the bottom right, you have the full 3D representation as where essentially each cell is colored in by its either zone or parameter value. So property zone values for a specific cell by cell can be edited through a CSV file. And for most of you, the CSV file will load in Excel as a default viewer, so it makes it easy to apply things like formulas or do batch or bulk editing of the values. You can see the example shown on the screen there. You just right-click on connectivity node from the tree and select edit property zone, and it'll load that into your CSV editor. The property zone values can also be exported to shapefile, both point and polygon with the corresponding attributes if you want to do further post-processing. So a few remarks about discontinuous layers. So as mentioned early on, MODFLOW-USG supports discontinuous layers. For simplicity, for now, within VModFlex, we assume that all the layers have the same discretization. Sublayering is something that we'll revisit in a future release, but we do support layers with zero thickness and pinchouts. So the areas where there's pinchouts or where the cells have zero thickness, they will be drawn in the 3D viewer. These cells are also set as inactive in the basic package when you do the translation, which means when you have vertical connections, then it'll bypass those inactive or zero thickness cells. So a few 3D illustrations in the top right there. You can see the layer that contains the blue cells. It has pinched out to zero thickness in that specific region, and those cells where there is zero thickness are not drawn. More simpler example in the bottom right, where you have a hole in an aquitard, which is colored in green there. You can see where the discontinuity occurs, and those cells aren't drawn in the 3D viewer. Looking at a concept of that in a cross-section view, you can see this model has six layers with six different property zones on the right. As you work from right to left, layers three and four slowly pinch out down to zero thickness, and you'll see that those zero thickness property zones are no longer shown in the left side of the cross-section. So in the past, you'd have to maintain a minimum layer thickness for zones 3 and 4 as you work your way across, but that's no longer required with MODFLOW-USG. So moving on, the boundary condition options are pretty similar to the properties. You have the ability to change the style settings and edit the attributes through a CSV file. So the boundaries can be shown as unstructured grid cells or as points. For the boundary cells, you can show the corresponding node ID for each one, which helps for doing editing while you're working with the parameter values. Or also, if you want to correlate what you see in the viewer to the river package or any of the boundary condition packages. The cells can be colored by a specific attribute. So for example, if you have a raster grid that defines recharge, after you do the numerical realization, you can color the recharge cells from highest to lowest based on the parameter value. So editing the boundary conditions is done in a similar way as I showed for property zones. You just right-click on the desired object in the tree, select Edit, and you'll see a CSV file appear depending on what editor you have. On my machine, it's Excel that loads by default. Again, the nice thing is you can utilize many of the capabilities that are built into Excel. So if you want to apply formula or easy copy and paste capability, that's right at your fingertips. And then, as you can see, you can correlate the node number for a specific river, well, constant head cells in the viewer to what you see in the CSV files to simplify the editing. In the next release, we'll work on improving the editing the geometry and also have 2D views so you can select specific cells and change the parameters. So this illustration shows what the river cells look like when you specify refinement around 200 meters for this example. You'll see the corresponding river shape file represented in the red line, and the image on the right is overlaid on top of the cell representation just to show you how the cells are generated from the river polyline atoms. A brief remark about the node numbering convention that we use in VModFlex. So when we generate the Voronoi cells, we start by numbering node number one with the model boundary polygon. I believe we start in the top left corner or the bottom left. I'm not too sure. I'll check in that. But you start by numbering the vertices around the polygon. Then we number the corresponding add-ins. First it's the polylines, then the points. And then we work in filling the gaps in between those regions. So all the remaining cells are numbered following those logic. And then we work from numbering the layers from layer one and then work your way downwards. So after you've viewed or added the boundary conditions, you can proceed on to adding your head observation, which is pretty straightforward. You import your head observations from an Excel or text file, then at this step you just map them into the numerical model. So you're then ready to create the input files for MODFLOW-USG, so you translate the numerical model to the USG packages. At this step, we have a simple text editor for doing editing of the packages, and this includes the solver parameters. So there's a GUI for the more commonly used options, like changing from steady state to transient, or choosing which property package you need to use. After that, the additional settings can be modified through this text editor window. So you can edit the solver parameters, change the number of time steps if you wish. Once you're done, you just save the changes in the text editor. That'll update the corresponding package on the hard disk, and then you're ready to run the model. A few quick remarks about the differences in the file formats for USG versus structured versions of MODFLOW. First, looking at the example for the bounding edition, for example, the river package, you have layer row column in MODFLOW 2005 in the example in the top right. And after that, you have the river stage, the conductance, and the riverbed bottom. With MODFLOW USG, as Sarab touched on last week, you now have a global node ID that identifies each cell. So the first column in the river package will be your node ID. After that, the remaining parameters are the same. So you have the stage, the conductance, and the riverbed bottom. The same format applies for all the bounding additions, so the well, constant head, drain, etc. Recharge and evapotranspiration are a little bit different since they're arrays. They're more similar to what you'd see for the property packages. Which leads me into the next slide. So when you're working, for example, with the LPF or the DCF package, with traditional MODFLOW, the first cell that you would see would be for layer 1, row 1, column 1. And with MODFLOW ESG, the first cell that you see will be correspond to node ID 1. The one to the right of that will be node ID 2, and then you work your way from that. A little remark down the bottom. I believe when we do the creation of the LPF and the BCF package, we put all layers into one file, so we don't have support yet for open and close statements for external references for each layer. So that's something we'll add likely when we get to the point of working on tests. One of the other benefits of these Voronoi grid cells that I didn't mention early on is that they're ideally suited for irregularly shaped model domains. So as most of you all know, when you have a regularly shaped model domain and you want to exclude cells outside, for example, a watershed polygon or whatnot, you have to mark those cells as inactive, and those are included in the basic package translation. So with the MODFLOW-USG and specifically these cell geometries, this is no longer required. So the node number one can start where it's specified in the model boundary, and you don't have to account for extra cells outside those regions of interest. So the running is pretty straightforward. You just run either using the 32 or 64 bit version. After the run is complete, you can then see the volumetric budget, which is extracted from the list file in the run log. So you can see the mass balance, identify any convergence problems. This is shown for each of the stress periods. And then you can, if necessary, go back and adjust your solver parameters or whatnot. After the model run is complete, you'll see the heads and drawdown are added to the model tree as shown here. The display settings for the calculated heads and drawdown are similar to what I showed previously for the properties. So you can show along a slice, color map with contour lines. You can show all the cells if you wish. This could be along for specific layers or along cross sections of different planes. You can also do cutaways if you wish, so you can correlate the heads to your observed conceptual model. The display settings, as shown on the tree there, are accessed just by right-clicking on the item in the tree and loading the settings menu. The calculated heads and drawdowns can also be exported to shapefiles, both point and polygon shapefiles. That would be for both steady-state and transient results. So if you have a transient model, we'll save the heads for every time step, or I believe you can choose which time steps you want to save, and each one will be saved as a new attribute in the shapefile in the DBF file. You can export the displays to higher resolution images, both bitmap and JPEGs. If you have a transient model or if you want to do rotations or whatnot, you can save these to an animation as an AVI file format. And if you have a transient model as well, the time settings can be accessed from the time node in the model tree as shown here. From here, you can see the list of available output times, select a different time, and apply the changes to the view to see the corresponding heads or drawdown at that new time. You can also look at the charts. This is pretty much identical to what you have with standard MODFLOW. So you have your calculated versus observed charts where you can filter observations by the layer where they exist, by specified times, and then you have your time series charts as well. So in summary, the key benefits we have in VMOD Flex are the four that are listed here. The first is the conceptual modeling capabilities. Really simplifies the generation of the grid and refinement around your areas of interest, specifically wells and boundaries. Within the conceptual model, we can handle discontinuous layers, so this sets it up nicely to be used for unstructured grid layers, and this can be done handling with pretty much very little effort. The multi-model environment makes it possible to evaluate multiple grids and achieve a balance between different runtimes and accuracy. As I mentioned before, you can try various levels of grid refinement to see which one is the most suitable for your project objectives. In addition, you can compare unstructured grid numerical models to traditional MODFLOW 2005 models and essentially show that you're getting a reasonable level of accuracy of results from both models. And that's also useful to help you get over the learning curve to understand the differences on how the solvers work, the notations for the packages, the grids, etc. The Voronoi grid cells that we use in Visual MODFLOW Flex provide stable grid geometry and efficient means of grid refinement. Since they closely honor the CVFD criteria, there's no need to use the ghost node correction, so we don't have support for that package in the first release, and it's something we may revisit if we decide to support other grid geometries down the road. So with this, these grid cells, you get higher accuracy and better convergence. And the 3D and cross-sectional views in VMOD Flex provide effective presentations and model displays. As mentioned, you can export out to various formats, create animations, etc. So it makes it ideally suited for presenting your results to your clients or to your stakeholders. Some of the next things we'll be working on after this release will be adding support for Zone Budget U. ModPath 3D is being developed from SS Papadopoulos, and we'll be providing them with some examples of Voronoi grid cells so they can test that. I believe their code is in the testing stage at this point. As mentioned, we have CLN working for wells currently. We just haven't put the finishing touches on that, so that'll be something we'll add as one of the first maintenance releases. And in addition, extending the CLN capabilities to fractures and conduits. We'll be regridding legacy MODFLOW 2005 models, bringing those in and either regrid with nested grids or Voronoi grid cells. I'd be open to hearing your suggestions on that, so if you have any comments or suggestions, please certainly let me know what your preference would be. And then we'll be adding cell-by-cell graphical editing through a 2D viewer. Lastly, probably towards early next year, we'll be looking at supporting pests for MODFLOW-USG. So for more details, you can go to the MODFLOW-USG page on our website as shown there. Just click on swstechnology.com/MODFLOW-USG. There's a demo video recorded and put on YouTube about a month ago. And if you're interested in beta testing the version that we have, please email me and I can send you the download instructions. With that, I'll open up for questions. And if there's time, I'll show a live demonstration. Let's see, there's a question. If you need to review a MODFLOW-USG model for a court case or litigation case, would you be able to view the model in VMODFLEX if all you have are the model input files? Not at this point, no. And I guess much of that will come with the grid specification file, the GSF, since right now MODFLOW-USG doesn't really clearly define what the cell geometry, so it's hard for GUIs to bring in the files and interpret what the cell shapes would be. So yeah, that is something we'll have to revisit next year. And also, I think just be useful to be to act as a model viewer for unstructured grid cells, since I don't believe there's anything being offered from the USGS at this point. If there's any other questions for those that are late joining the webinar, just use the chat option in WebEx, and I'll do my best to answer your question for you. All right, I will just go through a brief demonstration. This is very similar to what we have on YouTube, as mentioned. So if you go to YouTube and search for MODFLOW-USG, you should see this brief, I think it's 5 or 6 minutes of a small demonstration that we've done to highlight a simple example of unstructured grids. So in this conceptual model, we have the conceptual model already built with the properties, the geological structure, and the boundary conditions. So we have a polyline across the top that represents a constant head, a simple river along the bottom, and two pumping wells in the middle. This is a three-layer aquifer system with relatively simple geometry. So the unstructured grid generation is launched at the end of the conceptual model. So up until this point, we've defined the grid independent conceptual model with GIS data such as surfaces, shape files, raster grids, etc. We then launch the unstructured grid window, and by default, the conceptual boundaries will be included in the grid generator. So you have the two points representing the pumping wells are included, the constant head along the top is included, the polyline, and the river along the bottom, which you can't see because it overlaps the model. Polygon is included as well. In the second step here is where you specify your various refinement options and the number of roughly the cell size that you want to see. Triangle grid generator will provide some suggested defaults based on the grid space, based on the spacing between the various vertices and points, which you can easily adjust. And as mentioned, you can turn things on or off through here. So if you want to see, for example, 20 meter cell size approximately around your polylines and perhaps 5 meters around your wells, you can do that. Here is that gradation option that I mentioned before for changing the smoothing factor. You generate the unstructured grid. It's going to show you a preview of what that looks like in the 3D viewer. If you're not getting the level of accuracy that you want, you can easily go back and change each of these options and regenerate the grid. So after the grid generated, it's added to the model tree down in the bottom left here. You can see it's refined around the regions that I specified. So I have smaller cell size as I work my way towards that polyline that represented my conceptual model, that represented my constant head, I should say. And as I zoom in on the regions that represent the pumping wells, you can see that it's refined those nicely around those regions. And then lastly, the cell size has changed smaller as I approach the river polyline along the bottom of my model domain. So the grid can be added to a number of 3D views as you need to. You can do different cross-sections through the grid. You can correlate this to your conceptual model objects. And it's a nice way of doing a QAQC to see that the grid geometry has followed your conceptual model and your raw data. After that, you proceed on to converting to the numerical model. So you click on this button here, and as this proceeds, you'll see the numerical model objects are added to the model tree down in the bottom left here. And now you have a new navigator for navigating the unstructured grid workflow. So these buttons here let you go forward and back through the workflow. The items in the tree essentially show the steps that you're going to proceed through from start to finish. Once you've gone through the workflow once, you can easily go back and proceed to a specific step. So the first is to show the property representation. If I want to adjust the settings for any of the properties, I launch it from the tree as shown here. So if you want to see the cells colored by their zone ID, you can do that. In addition, if you want to see cross-section, you just load the cell settings, turn off all cells, and turn on a specific slice, for example. If I want to see a cross-section through the middle, I can show it as shown here. And this is nice if you want to correlate this to your numerical model. For example, if you want to correlate this to your conceptual model, you can display the corresponding, here are your conceptual model property zones, and this is your corresponding numerical grid representation. If you select edit property zone from the tree here, this is going to load the parameter values in a CSV file, as I mentioned, and this will let you make changes to individual cells or a bunch of cells as you wish. In this example, the initial heads were defined using a surfer grid. So if you want to color the cells by the initial head value, you just go into the color rendering and turn on attribute here. And now you can see that the initial head value for each of the grid cells. You can turn on a color legend for the 3D view to help you correlate what red means and what blue means, obviously. And then that can be saved to an image file or to an AVI file if you wish. Next, you'll look at the boundary conditions and do editing as necessary. So here are the cell representations of the boundary conditions. I'll just make the view a little bit bigger. So these points that you see here are the pumping well cells that were generated from the point objects. From the settings, you can turn on things such as the cell ID, so I'll do that now. So now what you see is the corresponding cell ID for the pumping well cells. You can do the same thing for your other boundary condition types, both polylines and polygons. And then if you want to look at the parameter values for the pumping well, you just click on Add Attribute. That's going to load your CSV file again. And then you can use that to correlate the node IDs that you see to what's in the CSV file. So from here, you can make changes to the pumping rates, apply any formula or batch editing as you wish, and then resave the changes. The head observation step is pretty straightforward. You just map your head observations from the tree to the input here. Then you get to the translate step where you have different settings for choosing between steady state or transient run. This is a transient model. You click on the translate. It's going to create the input packages for MODFLOW-USG and provide a separate tab for each package that allows you to preview and edit the values if you wish. So here's your DISU package where you have the cell elevations, the connections, the connection lengths, etc. Here's your basic and property package. This is the river package where you have the node ID and the corresponding stage and conductance in the bottom. If you want to change the solver parameters, you can do that through here. So for example, if you want to loosen some of the conversions criteria, you just change the value that you have here. And if you right-click in the window, you can save those parameters and that'll update the input package directly. And then lastly, you have the name file, which links all the corresponding parameter values, all the corresponding packages. You then run the simulation. After the simulation is complete, it's going to add the heads or drawdown to the tree in the bottom left here. If there's any non-convergence errors, you'll see error pop up indicating where the convergence failed. And then as mentioned before, you'll see the summary of the volumetric budget from the list file in this run log. So you can see if there's any mass balance issues for each of the stress periods. Lastly, you view the calculated heads or drawdown from the results. As mentioned before, the settings are accessed from the tree here. So for example, if you want to see a color map, you just turn off the display options that you don't need and turn on the ones you do need. Turn off the lines, show a color map for layer 3. Let's try that. And also show ISO lines for layer 3. So now you have the contours of head drawn for layer 3, which you can view as a projected plane or show as a 3D view. Since it's a transient model, you can access calculated heads at different time steps just by going to the time option here. And then as I change the output time, you should see the calculated heads are updated here. So the results can be exported to shapefiles, as I mentioned, or the 3D display can be exported to images or to ABI files as you need to. The charts are available from this step in the workflow, and as mentioned, it's very similar to what you're going to see with standard MODFLOW. You have your calculated versus observed with the statistics, and then also your time series chart. So after you've run through a specific numerical model, if you wish, you can go back to the conceptual model workflow, create another unstructured grid if you're not happy with the level of accuracy that you're reaching with the previous one, and run through the same steps again. So convert it to a numerical model, translate it and run. In the tree here, you're going to see a new numerical model tree is added. And on the hard disk, you're going to have a separate set of MODFLOW USG packages stored in its own directory for each model run. I think that covers most of the key improvements we made for Visual MODFLOW Flex. I'm getting close to the time expiry, so if you have any other questions at this time, please use the chat option and we'll try and wrap up in the next few minutes.